Welcome into Mining Stock Daily. We have a corporate update and an interview with one of our sponsors. That's Ascot Resources. Ascot trades on the TSX with AOT and also on the OTCQX with AOTVF. Happy to welcome in once again President and CEO, Mr. Derek White. Derek, pleasure to see you. Happy holidays to you.
Yeah, the same to you, Trevor. Thanks for having me on your show.
Christmas came a little bit early for Ascot. You were able to raise some money, $105 million, to continue advancing and get the premier project into real development here. You and I continued to talk about this over the last, over the last year, basically, about when this financing was going to come down the line. You weren't raising, when it comes to putting a mine into construction and really getting it up to producing stage, you didn't have to raise a lot of money compared to a lot of other projects. But Derek, you made it look pretty easy, I must say.
Well, thank you, Trevor. I wish I could tell you that it was really easy. But, look, when the company was looking at some of the different risks that it faced, clearly, having the capital as a junior mining company or a developer is obviously very important. And the market wants to understand, how are you going to finance this and what does that mean for me? And the board of the company appointed a finance committee, and we looked at a number of different proposals. And even though there was COVID going on, we were able to get technical agents from the potential lenders up to the site. And that really narrowed down to two players. We were looking to raise plus or minus around 100 million US of debt. And Sprott and the BD Group, which is a group out of Vancouver, kind of came to the party. And we settled on trying to make sure that we would have a senior debt and a subordinated debt. And the company was really trying to negotiate and at what it felt was best for shareholders. But there were three things that were really important to us. Number one is we didn't want to give up too much gold upside. So, we see a lot of people going into streams, and I know that's not debt, but if you have a real bull run in gold prices, you're giving a lot of that upside away. And so we tried to stay away from that a little bit. The second thing is, we really wanted to have a certain amount of flexibility, and we have to tailor our debt in how we draw down and if we need to refinance in the future. And so we wanted to make sure we didn't have too many restrictions on us. And then the third thing is cost of funds. And I think what we found in this structure that we presented to the market yesterday is, we were able to achieve those three things. We didn't end up having a gold stream or we have a small gold production, but it's not anything like a stream or whatever. We're not giving a lot of the gold upside away. Number two is the interest rates in this package. In the pre-construction phase, if you like, in the construction phase, we're at LIBOR plus 7%, and then once it gets into production, we drop to LIBOR plus 5.75%. So that's, for a company that's a developer, that's a pretty decent rate of funding. Typically we see a lot higher than that. And then I think thirdly, we have the flexibility, especially after 2 years, to make some decisions about the timing of what we do with Red Mountain. And if you've been following the company, we've been having a lot of success west of the Premier and west of the Big Missouri. And it may look like Premier has a longer life, and we may not go quite as quickly over to Red Mountain, but we'll have to see. And we think the package allows us the flexibility to make some of those decisions. So I think all in all, the team worked hard, and we were able to get it to happen. I wouldn't necessarily say it was easy, but it was, we were able to do it. And we really said to the market, it's going to come out sometime in early December, and we wanted to deliver on that promise. So, thanks to BD and Sprott as well, because they cooperated with us, and sometimes these things can drag out forever. But it puts the company in a good position now.
Yeah, what's interesting, given the timing and really at the height of this pandemic, that this financing, more or less, you were geographically constrained to where the money could come from. I mean, that's actually really fascinating.
Yeah, it is. And, the other thing that I found fascinating in this process, if you asked me a year ago, could you negotiate a debt deal where you're doing it kind of virtually over Zoom or Skype or Teams, and no one's ever going to physically meet? And I would have said, not a chance. But, society, I think, has just accepted this is the way it is for now. And we're learning how to do things where we physically don't come in contact with each other. But, the parties have to want to try and get something done. And I think in this case, both the lenders were pretty cooperative, and we were able to make that work.
Yeah, I mean, you've raised money for development before. This isn't your first go around, but you know, you obviously you just said this could be done, you know, in a virtual platform, but you don't want to continue to do it this way down the road.
No, I mean, I like to see people face to face and, you know, and whatever. And I'm sure we're going to go back to a more normal situation. You know, in our situation, what's also unusual is Hyder, Alaska, although it has no border, there's no U.S. border there. Technically, we're going into the U.S. and going back into Canada and coming back into Canada all on the same day. And from a COVID perspective, that was a bit of an issue. And the border security from Canada and the Canadians effectively adopted Hyder as kind of like a satellite city and allow us to go back and forth every day and allow Hyder to come into Stewart. So, you know, I think common sense is prevailing. Eventually, people are doing things out of necessity, but no, this is no way for us to work. And I'm hoping the pandemic will end shortly. I'm looking forward to seeing the vaccine come out. And, you know, as we go into construction, hopefully this summer when we get the ball mill and sag mill arriving, hopefully COVID will be behind us. Yeah. But we'll just have to wait and see.
Oh, I'm looking forward to that border being open so I can actually go up and see the project sometime.
Oh, yeah, you're more than welcome. Absolutely.
You did a nice job walking through kind of what this deal is made up of. I do have a couple of follow-up questions. The financing is comprised of an $80 million senior credit facility. In this bullet points, you'll find in the news release, which breaks down this financing, there is a $13 per ounce production linked payment for the first 450,000 ounces produced. Is that payment going down to pay that credit line down initially? Is that the first payment?
No.
Okay.
It's just a fee.
It's a
way for whatever reason, it seems to be common for the senior debt players now to have this. We've seen it in other debt deals. It's a fixed fee of $13 per ounce, and it's a way of getting additional money from the borrower.
Okay, very interesting. But this isn't classified as a stream by any means.
No, it's not. No, you know, like it doesn't change in price, and it doesn't change in quantity. It's just once on the first 450,000 ounces, we have to pay $13 an ounce, okay. And it doesn't go. You know, the gold upside is for the shareholder.
All right. But it can be. You can basically pay that off quickly.
We can, yeah, we can. And we can also repay it. And especially after 2 years, we can refinance the whole debt deal if we want to.
Okay. Oh, very interesting. You know, what's kind of been the feedback here from shareholders that you've gotten from this? I would say it was pretty positive.
Yeah, I think, you know, first of all, I think people were happy to see the quantum and they were happy to see the interest rate. I think there was a little bit confusion on the interest rate. So just as I said before, you know, basically you have a pre-production interest rate of LIBOR plus 7 and then a post-production of LIBOR plus 5.5. But, you know, I think people were surprised a little bit that we were able to do this. And I haven't had anybody come back and go, I really don't like this package. And I think the other thing is the market was happy about is, look, you didn't put a big gold stream on this and take all the upside away from us. You know, I think that was also a big thing. I think the last one, you know, people want to know a little bit about the conversion fees features of the BD debt. And the way that works is it has two tranches. So tranche one, it was drawn down yesterday, and that's a 20% premium to the 30-day VWAP as of yesterday. It's around $1.32 Canadian that they have the right to convert if they want. And the second tranche, when we draw it down, which would be when we get our Mines Act Permit Amendment, will be at market at that time. And so, you know, I think people get that and they understand that. I think, you know, one of the nervousness in projects that have a lot of capital is that you're going to raise a big equity check, and basically that's going to really dilute the shareholders, and that's a big issue. In our deal, and just so we're clear for everybody, is right now, you know, we probably have about 50 million Canadian in the bank. We just paid off the CD, so basically when we drew the tranche, the 10 million tranche from BD, we basically paid off Sprott's CD, so we really kind of replaced one CD with another, and that now goes out for 4 more years. And the equity that we need to put in place basically by the end of June is around 25 million. And, you know, so we have a number. We don't have to do anything right away. We've got a long time to kind of work this out. We've talked to a lot of our shareholders, and we think it's a relatively small additional capital. And really, why do we need that? the way we looked at the funding was we had 110 million for the project. We needed at least 10 million to repay Sprott for the existing CD. And we probably want something like about $15 million worth of working capital to be out there. And the combination of, you know, kind of the money we have in the bank, the financing, and the drawdowns of the debt, we think we're good to go.
Okay. So what does this look like? Kind of take a step back. Simplify for me. Will you be going back to the market to raise capital to get this done 2021?
Yes, okay. We will come back between now and the end of June to raise an additional $25 million of capital.
Okay, your explanation was much more thorough than my question was. Just trying to simplify. All right, Derek, this is great. I actually just kind of wanted to maybe one last holistic question about this. I mean, this is just one step closer not only to getting another operating mine in the Golden Triangle, but another one in the entire province. So this is big. This is big news for mining in BC in general. Can you provide a comment on that? I mean, given everything that's going on, both on the pandemic and governmentally wise throughout the country of Canada and the province, why is this significant?
Well, look, British Columbia has had a long history. Like California, it was kind of founded on the gold rush. I mean, people came up here to mine gold, and that's what brought people to British Columbia in the first place. And, over the last probably 10 years, I think we've lost our way a little bit. And between First Nations issues and regulatory requirements, it's been hard. I mean, there has been some things. Pretium was probably the last big mine, which is 40 kilometers north of us, that got built in July of 2017. So it certainly can be done, but the Golden Triangle offers some tremendous mineralization, and it has just been tough for companies, either because they don't have the infrastructure because the capital cost is too big, or they just couldn't get the time frame to do that. And I think hopefully what Ascot's going to show over the next little while is that, especially with our partners, the Nisga'a Nation, who are very supportive of what we're doing, we're going to show that, a mine can be built profitably and in a reasonable time frame in British Columbia, because you have to remember that the management team came here a little bit under 3 years ago, and we had no resources at all. And yes, we had a lot of infrastructure, but we've been able to put the resources together, get through the, kind of initial permitting and work with the Nisga'a Nation in a 3-year period. And, there's a lot of gold mines when you start, it takes 10 years to put them in place. So hopefully it'll send a message that, British Columbia is open for business. And that the regulators and the First Nations and the mining companies are going to work together to try and make investors see that this is a place that things can work.
You've put a resource together, but it sounds like you've got more ounces adding.
We do. And, we were very fortunate this summer. We seem to have extensions to both the Premier and the Big Missouri to the west. And, this is an area with a lot of historical gold, and next summer we'll be back up there infill drilling it. We'd like to see these numbers come into the mine plan because they're right next to mining infrastructure. So, it's all looking very good for us at the moment.
Derek, it's a pleasure to speak with you. Again, congratulations, happy holidays, and look forward to hearing more from you and Ascot in the new year.
Yeah, take care, Merry Christmas, and best of the season to you, Trevor.